Good morning, folks. How are you this morning? Ron Bishop's my name, from Timaru, New Zealand. And I'm leading a campaign to change the New Zealand employment law in New Zealand, because it's wrong, and I'm leading a campaign to try and get it changed. What I'm going to do this morning is I'm using my case, Christine Bennett, a worker of mine, whom I dismissed, made a claim against me, a personal grievance claim, and she won her case. And I'm going to be talking this morning about that case, and I'll be reading from documents that were filed in that case. Under the Employment Relations Act 2000, in the Employment Court Christchurch Registry, file number CRC1, Bar 10. In the matter of statement of defence of the cross-challenge made by the defendant, and in the matter of a counterclaim made by the plaintiffs against the defendant and other defendants named in the body of this counterclaim, between Ronald Edward Bishop and Margaret Ellen Bishop of Glenetty Road, Timaru, trading as Debtor Communications, formerly of 4 Wilkham Street, Timaru. And the plaintiff, they were the plaintiffs. The defendant is Christine Florence Bennett of College Road, Timaru. 2. The defendant and the Registrar of the Employment Court. Statement of defence of cross-challenge and counterclaim by the plaintiffs. These documents have been prepared and filed by Ronald Edward Bishop, employment advocate, representing the above partnership trading as Debtor Communications. Debtor Communications counterclaim 2010. Defence of cross challenge. Defendant's cross challenge. Clause 33. The Employment Relations Authority awarded the defendant the sum of $9,000 for compensation and hurt and humiliation under Section 23 of the Employment Relations Act. Plaintiff's reply was true. Clause 34, since the 8th of January 2010, Mr. Bishop has posted 9 articles on a publicly accessible directory website which he operates under timarudirectory.co.nz, criticising Miss Bennett's character and conduct and making allegations of dishonesty. Plaintiffs said, denied with reasons for denial below. Number 1. At the date of the cross-challenge, there were 14 articles written by Mr. Bishop on his business directory website. Number 2. These articles were in the main criticising anomalies in the Employment Relations Act 2000 and were not intended to discredit Ms. Bennett's character. Number 3. The case was already public knowledge, having been reported on front page news in the Timaru Herald, so the writer of the articles assumed he was not breaking the law by voicing his opinion on a subject that affects the lives of all New Zealanders. Number 4. Out of respect for Ms. Bennett, the articles have now been removed from the website while the case is before the Employment Court, but the headlines remain, which are as follows. Number 1. Bishop ordered to pay sacked employer. Number 2. Happy birthday to me. Number 3. Corruption in the employment industry. Number 4. Why the employment laws are corrupt. Number 5. Does anybody care? Send us your story. Number 6. Honest solicitor wanted. Number 7. Sacked woman preys on good-natured boss. Number 8. It's not about us anymore, it's about the kids. Number 9. Support required for employment law reform. Number 10. Woman puts fear into an elderly couple using a false document. Number 11, Rules and Regulations of New Zealand Employment Law, Part 1. Number 12, The Greatest Motivational Book of All Time. Number 13, How low can they go? And number 14, A Judge Without Legal Qualifications. Clause 35. As a result of posting these articles, the defendant has suffered emotional stress, humiliation and anxiety over losing personal and professional reputation in her community and her employment. Denied. The defendant's emotional stress, humiliation and anxiety began the day she was dismissed from her employment from another employer in the year 2002. Her stress has increased since then as a result of her desire to use the Employment Relations Act 2000 for financial gain. Clause 36. The defendant seeks to increase the award of compensation to $20,000 on the grounds that Mr. Bishop's continued conduct since the dismissal was the issue of the Employment Relations Authority's determination has caused her further hurt and humiliation. Clause 36 is denied for reasons which are explained in the attached counterclaim. Debtor Communications Counterclaim 2010. Counterclaim to the Cross Challenge. The plaintiffs Ronald Edward Bishop and Margaret Ellen Bishop, trading as Debtor Communications from 132 Glenny Road to Maru, claim compensation and damages for frustration, emotional distress, anxiety, humiliation and defamation of character caused by individuals and organisations. The plaintiffs have listed over 30 witnesses they could call on in court, but in their counterclaim to the trust challenge they have identified the main witnesses they allege have played a part in destroying their business and their lives. The first defendant, Christine Florence Bennett of Timaru. Slander and defamation. In the last few days leading up to the first defendant's dismissal, plaintiff's Mr. Bishop was told by the first defendant on more than one occasion that people she knew were saying that he had a mental health problem. Number two, in a letter to the plaintiff, Mrs. Bishop, on the 14th of October 2008, the defendant told her that she knew her husband had health problems. Number three, on the 17th of September 2008, the plaintiffs received a copy of a letter, written to the Disputes Mediation Tribunal by the first defendant. Paragraph 2 of the letter obtained the following words. Mr. Bishop has bipolar disorder, which can create unpredictable behaviour on a regular basis. The letter was circulated to the offices of the Department of Labour, the Employment Relations Authority, Timaru Law Firms Raymond Sullivan McGlashan, and possibly to other unknown recipients. The plaintiff, Mr. Bishop, wrote to the first defendant on the September 2008, informing her that the letter was defamatory and that legal proceedings against her would eventuate unless he received a written apology. No apology has been received by the plaintiffs from the first defendant. The plaintiff gave the first defendant a second chance to apologise at the mediation hearing, but the first defendant chose not to apologise and walked out of the meeting. Number six, the plaintiff's claim was the first defendant deliberately used the defamation remarks to influence the thinking of those involved in the case, which resulted in the plaintiffs losing their case with the Employment Relations Authority. Number eight, the plaintiffs claim the sum of $20,000 in compensation from Ms. Bennett for her defamatory remarks, which caused damage to the plaintiff's good standing in the community, making it difficult for him to earn an income. The second defendant, National Bank of New Zealand Custodians Limited, whose shareholders are the ANZ Bank of Wellington. Number one, the first defendant is a former employee of the National Bank in Timaru and was instrumental in organising a reunion of the Timaru staff to be held in her wine bar. Number two, the plaintiffs claim the staff of the National Bank in Timaru failed in their duty to protect the privacy of the plaintiff's bank accounts from the first defendant by permitting her to open an investment account in the name of Debtor Communications without their written authority just a few days after being employed by the plaintiffs in November 2006. The plaintiffs were told the bank account was opened by a call received at their call centre in Auckland, but the call was not recorded and the bank was not able to provide the name of the person who made or received the call. The banking ombudsman initially recommended the plaintiff should be paid $500 from the bank for an inconvenience, but changed it to nil after reading the third defendant, Helen Dawes, determination. The plaintiffs also claimed that on July 2007, the National Bank staff assisted the first defendant to purchase foreign exchange using funds from the plaintiff's trust account, which belonged to their clients. Number six, the Timaru National Bank staff failed to contact the plaintiffs when the first defendant presented checks to the bank that were signed by the first defendant, Ms. Bennett, who did not have signing authority. The plaintiffs from the banking ombudsman recommended the bank make a refund to them for the brokerage fee of $22.24 only on the $22,000 of foreign exchange money that the first defendant withdrew from their client's trust account. Number eight, the plaintiffs have been banking with the National Bank for some 50 years and feel the Timaru Bank staff has let them down by not attempting to contact them in person to resolve the issues that were vital to the success of their business. Number nine, the plaintiffs claim the sum of $20,000 in compensation and damages caused by the bank in the early stages of the first defendant's employment with Data Communications. Third defendant, Fidelity Life Insurance Company Limited, having registered office at Garton Road, Newmarket, Auckland. General Manager Paul Mason. At the beginning of 2007, the plaintiffs claimed that the sales manager of Fidelity Life Assurance in Christchurch visited the offices of their business Data Communications in Timaru and signed a personal agreement with their staff member, Miss Bennett, which permitted her to sell life insurance in her own name using the plaintiff's trading name, Timaru Finance Brokers. Number two, the plaintiffs claim that Fidelity Life Insurance staff assisted the defendant to place insurance software on the Data Communications main debt collection computer, which allowed her to give insurance quotes over the phone. Number three, the plaintiffs claim that the Fidelity Life staff member was aware that the first defendant was an employee of Data Communications and would be receiving an hourly rate of pay by the plaintiffs in addition to receiving commission on the policy she sold. The plaintiffs claim that the Fidelity staff member... Number three, the plaintiffs claim that the Fidelity staff member was aware that the first defendant was an employee of Data Communications and would be receiving an hourly rate of pay by the plaintiffs in addition to receiving commission on the policy she sold. The plaintiffs claim the Fidelity Life staff deposited the first defendant's life insurance commission in the plaintiff's new investment bank account without their permission. The plaintiffs claimed $20,000 from Fidelity Life in compensation for the many hours of work and worry it took to unravel the mystery of what happened as a result of the deception.